right, welcome back to JKL, powered by Telkom. And speaking of power, I have a powerful woman seated across from me, Honorable Dennitah Ghati. Thank you so much for coming in. You know, some people may take for granted, you went to Columbia University. Now, I schooled in the U.S. as well. Columbia University is no joke, Ivy League. Tell us about that experience before we get more into your story.
Yeah, Columbia, and I'm happy that I went to Columbia. I am actually a graduate of Columbia. Yeah. Columbia, as you say, is an Ivy League, you know, it's in the league of, you know, Harvard.
It's a serious school, yes.
It's a serious school, yeah. UPenn, Yale, and, you know.
Princeton.
Princeton,
yes.
Exactly. Yeah. So, yeah, that's why I did my master's. I did a Master of Science in Social Work and International Affairs from both, you know, the School of Social Work and SIPA. So, yes, I am a graduate of Columbia, and I'm so happy. A very great institution,
yes.
of higher education. So I'm delighted to be to be a graduate, an alumni of Columbia in New York.
So you have such a wide and diverse background. Before you got into politics, you were a journalist, and before the break, we were talking about how different would the industry be if Honorable Ghati was not Honorable Ghati, but a journalist here. You know, and we're missing that kind of seasoned voice when it comes to the industry. Why did you leave the media?
I left the media because I wanted a different experience. I mean, I'm a journalist by you know, by training. I'm trained from the Kenya Institute of Mass Communication, KMC, I've practiced journalism. Actually, I've really done a lot of journalism work, becoming both a features editor and a news editor from the Standard Group. You know, back then at Likoni Road, I remember Likoni and I&M building. So I decided that really, apart from writing and editing, you know, articles, I really needed another different platform, yeah, where I really could now, you know, translate what, you know, I used to write and edit into probably something that can really influence policy. Mm. So, you know, that way I then got into the NGO sector. I've really worked a lot in the NGO sector. The latest having worked from, I was with AfriAfia and UNICEF Somalia in Somaliland.
Wow.
Where I came to, you know, get myself into politics. So I am just a jack of all trades.
No, absolutely. And when we think about now in terms of politics, you came in as the first women's rep for Migori County.
Right.
Let's shift gears a bit to current affairs. Of course, what happened there, very unfortunate news of the young lady, Sharon Otieno, who lost her life. The circumstances still not very clear. But what do you make of what happened to her? And of course, a lot of social media reaction to that.
I think it's extremely unfortunate, and it's unfortunate coming again from my county, yeah, my county of birth and representation. Of course, you know, any other girl, if anything happens to any other girl from any other county in this country, is completely unacceptable. Mm. There is a young girl, and a young girl pursuing her education and, you know, trying to make her life. And I'm actually surprised that to learn that the girl was actually also expectant.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
you know, those are two lives, you know, lost like that, you know. So for me, as a gender and especially as a woman and girls champion, really, it is unfortunate, and it is actually even a shame,
yeah,
whatever happened to that girl. We are hearing a lot of conflicting information, which of course we are yet to put pieces together, mm, to know exactly what happened. But let me tell you, Vicky, really in this country, life is extremely precious. Life is extremely precious. You know what we've gone through from the election and all what followed thereafter, and I think nobody has a right to take the life of another, yeah, absolutely not, and it is actually inhuman, it is criminal. Whatever has happened to my you know, that is my county mate, she's from my county, and yeah, she's really it should not happen to any woman anywhere. And I'm also surprised to see even the journalist, Barack, having been a journalist, I know what it means to get the story.
Yes.
You know, the miles we have to go through,
absolutely,
to get the story. So, you know, and really harassing a journalist like that, and it's a shame, Vicky. It is really a shame. And for me, what I know and I always say is that any insult to a journalist, mm, is an insult to the entire profession. It's an insult to the entire media fraternity. So for me, really, we really have to style up as a people.
Yeah.
And I really want to call upon upon the DPP and the DCI should actually bring the culprits to book. It should not happen anywhere. It should not happen in Migori. It should not happen in Turkana. It should not happen anywhere. You know, it is for me, it is a shame. And really, we have to really answer. And I stand actually with the family of this girl.
Yeah.
I stand with her, Sharon's family, to demand justice. We want to know what exactly happened to the child, to that university student. She was pursuing her education in Rongo University, which is also in my county of birth, the county of Migori. And so I can imagine, you know, you can imagine what the family is going through. Yeah. I mean, you know how much education is in this country.
Yeah. Yeah.
Quite expensive, and it's really unfortunate that this is happening.
And you mentioned how precious life is. You know that all too well,
absolutely,
having gone through a tragic accident in March 2014, and your life shifted. You went from being the women rep for Migori County. Take us through how difficult it was now, because of course you had to go back and forth between Nairobi and your county to ensure that things are going well. But now, no longer having the use of your limbs, and you're having to now gain a voice in a society that oftentimes leaves you out.
Right.
You were born able-bodied. You could walk.
I was born a normal child.
Yeah.
I was born a normal child, an extremely normal child growing up in the rural, you know, Kuria. By the way, I come from Kuria, and Kuria is a community in Migori.
Yeah.
And just a minority community there, some little percentage that we command. But I found myself, that is my county. And of course, my disability, I would tell you that my disability contributed to my, being able to defend my seat.
Yeah.
And that is what tells you what what people with disability, for example, go through.
Yes.
Obviously, people with disability are always, you know, left behind in terms of thinking. I mean, if we look at persons with disability, generally the perception and the way society views people with disability and the whole stigma, you know, you are already kind of labeled that you cannot do it. You know, you're unable. Vicky, you know, I've lived the two lives. I've lived a life with a disability, and I lived a life without a disability. So I really know what it means to actually lack something when you are disabled. There are places in this country that I used to attend to really visit at my pleasure.
Yeah.
And right now I completely cannot go there. I cannot go to a hotel, for example. I cannot go to, you know, a public space, for example. So people with disability in this country, and there are many, we are many.
Yeah.
The moment you are actually a person with disability is when you will understand what challenges people with disability go through.
Did you feel like you had to start from scratch? Because you are an incredibly accomplished woman, went to an Ivy League, worked in the NGO, in the media, politics, accomplishing first as the first Korean woman to be elected into parliament. So you had a lot that you had done. The accident happens,
right,
and all of a sudden it's like, you had done absolutely nothing with your life.
It shatters your life. I can tell you for sure. An accident like this that I went through, you know, it is a whole life-changing experience. I mean, there are things that you know, it's like you go back to stage one. You know, it's like you are learning to, you know, to get yourself in order and try to. It's like you need another re-socialization.
Mm.
You see, because you know, there's nothing as dangerous as getting a disability when you are at your adult stage.
Yes.
I was in my 33rd. Year. I was 33 years when I got an accident.
In my prime. Yeah.
You know, I had just gotten into parliament, you know, this young and vibrant, you know, young woman becoming a member of parliament, and especially from a minority community for the first time. And then, you know, you envision a life, you know, and then all of a sudden after 1 year and I find myself in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
I've actually been on this wheelchair for now for 5 years.
Mm.
And so, you know, there's so many things that you kind of, you know, want to learn, to understand. So that is the reason why, you see, for me, it is better to understand the challenges that people with disability face. First, because I was without a disability, so I knew what I was getting accessible to. And now here I am confined to a wheelchair, and most of the things now you realize when people with disability talk about exclusion, there is serious exclusion, because I feel excluded. It's only that probably I know so much because I wasn't with a disability when I was born. So once you know what you can access, what you're entitled to, so it is easier for me to talk about accessibility, for example. It is easier for me to talk about issues that people with disability are talking about. Look at persons with disability. I am telling you, in almost every circle in this country, we are left behind. We are left behind. And I can tell you, unless you live that life of being disabled, you can never understand what people with disability go through.
Yeah.
I am in Parliament now, courtesy of course, my party, which is ODM party, which has taken me to Parliament in this 12th Parliament to actually basically look at issues of disability.
And you know, one thing that is a reality for people, the pain of someone who was able-bodied now transitioning into being disabled, not having use of your limbs, friends leave, oftentimes family, having people adjust to the new you. What was that like?
You know, first of all, there's a rejection from the from close people. Those people you felt were, you know, because it is really not intentional rejection. It is because they are also shocked. How do they deal with this person, this new person that they are really not used to dealing with? You know, there is denial. I mean, I was in denial. I wouldn't deny. I wouldn't lie to you. I was extremely in denial. If you saw me in the last parliament, I was extremely in denial. Here I was. I wanted to kind of assume that I was not in that situation, and I really needed a lot of counselling. And people actually, you lose a lot of friends, even close friends, even members of parliament who you were so close like this. You know, because you're not in the same league. You know, they kind of view you as, you know, you are disabled. You know, that is usually the tag that you are disabled. And so you are actually not able to do this thing. And so you see it. And I can tell you, Vicky, I'm telling you, the whole issue that you see we people with disability talking about exclusion is real. And that is why you see we always try to lobby and really talk about, you know, now we have this mantra that you've had, nothing about us without us, leaving no one behind.
Right.
As for me, as a member of parliament, I sit pretty in parliament. I sit pretty on my wheelchair and I articulate issues of disability. I do my work, I do my political life the same way, because what I am trying to do now that I know the life of being without a disability and having a disability, for me, what I tend to do now is to make sure that we try somehow to bridge the gap. How then do we bridge this gap? I am in parliament. What I do is basically to look at those areas, those structures, those opportunities that are actually closed, because I know what it means to enjoy those rooms when I did not have a disability. And now that I have a disability, it's very easier for me to tell this is wrong. This is I'm being denied. And you can imagine the 6.5 million Kenyans that have a disability in this country.
And still on the issue of relationships, because I know people are curious about finding love. Prior to the accident, you had plans to settle down.
Of course.
What happened to that relationship, and is there something brewing now?
Well, I'm alive, as you can see. I'm alive, as you can see, and you can tell. I am in a relationship, of course, and it's a relationship that we respect one another. I mean, I would call it a partnership kind of, you know. So, I am moving on, and I'm enjoying every bit of it. So, the marriage plans, you know, kind of stalled a little bit. You know, as I've told you, people are in shock. You know, here you are. And you know, you kind of relax a bit, and you also reassess yourself. I mean, what do I want really? Is it genuine? You know, because I'm telling you, this country is also very hard. If you talk to women with disability, for example, people with disability, when it comes to, for example, issues of social life, issues of dating, it is just kind of abnormal for people to get into, and that is part of life. That is life, but you see, it is somehow it's a little bit not kind of acceptable. Mm-hmm. I've been in situations where I have held a lot of discussions with women, issues of you know, sexual reproductive health, and you know, those are the topics that we talk about.
Yeah.
And you know, when you hear the challenges that women, for example, find when they want to fall in love and they want to, you know, have families and the normal life.
And I'm curious, how did you deal with the rejection? You mentioned there were plans to settle down. It didn't materialize after the accident. How did you deal with that? Because like you said, women with disabilities deal with far much more emotionally.
Extremely. And you know, And I would be honest with you. I got an accident when I was at my prime. I mean, I was in a relationship. I was dating. And so, you know, it kind of puts you back. And, you know, both of you start to think, you know, of the future. Do you think this will work? Do you think, you know, so many things come about. And so we had to stop it, because I also needed time to heal myself and, right. and find myself in order. And so... those are the challenges that women really face. And I can tell you, it has not been easy, but again, with time and with socialization and with acceptance and with, you know, we have to change how people view people with disabilities in this country. That way we are able to, and that is the reason why I can tell you for sure, the way a child with disability is socialized, you see, that child with a disability is facing discrimination right at home.
Yeah.
You know, you find situations, I've seen situations where parents with children with disability do not even want their neighbors to know that they have a child with disability. And that is a neighbor who lives there. That child cannot actually be taken out to get vitamin D, which is actually the sun. And, you know, those kind of, you know, the stigma that neighbors, you know, you tend to fear. A parent with a child with disability tends to fear, what will neighbors think?
Right.
Therefore, you kind of, you kind of tie your child inside your home because you don't want that child to be seen. You don't want to be mocked. That child, you are denying that child education, right. because that child does not go to school. That child is usually the last to go. Let me tell you, in research, we have actually found that children with disability, children of school-going age, children with disability are usually the last children to get into school. And they're usually the first children to drop out of school. Mm. In situations where a parent, for example, wants to educate, has two children,
yeah.
one with a disability, one without a disability, who is likely to fall out of school? It is this only disability.
Speaking of because children,
you'll be kept there.
You have a daughter.
I have a beautiful daughter.
Yes. Tell She's us about eight. Her. Did she give you a sense of hope to keep going?
Yeah, I had my daughter before the accident,
yes,
and obviously before I got into Bunge, immediately before I got into Bunge, into Parliament. So this child of mine, really, obviously, she's eight, and she's just amazing, and she has seen me through all this, life, and she's the one who actually kind of reminds me, oh, mommy, when you used to drive, you know, you used to carry this, you used to put me in this basket, you know, she's just amazing, and she's actually my strength, you know. I I'm a mom of one. And that is my center. That is where my whole life, you know, is, because she's my job, and she's my child. And then I have this job that really keeps me on toes. And therefore, for me, what I do is basically to try to make life beautiful for her.
Yeah.
Because if you look at like what I have done, the moment I went down into this disability club, because we call it a disability club for some of us who join in, I found my foundation, because I came up with a foundation. My foundation is actually called the Dennitah Ghati Disability Foundation. So this is a foundation that basically tries to make life beautiful for people with disabilities, and especially children,
right.
because that is where I have realized there's a lot of nothing much is put there. Children with disability, because you see, here you have a parent who is struggling to accept this child,
right.
who has a disability, and so they are excluded. So what I do basically within that disability foundation that I found when I got into this this club is basically to kind of make life beautiful for children with disability, making sure that I identify through my friends and my networks to identify people with disabilities, children with disabilities who actually need support.
Mm.
Because I run a program that basically helps me identify children with disabilities who need scholarships to go to school, who need support
right.
in terms of going to school. So I have a lot of partners that I partner with. And so it also keeps me going, because part of what I do is that I make sure that my salary that I get from Parliament, I basically put a portion to support my foundation
Amazing.
And activities that can actually go to help others who are actually disabled. Kujaribu kuinua hao, so that they are able to see life as normal. Because
Amazing.
For me, I've lived the two worlds.
Yeah.
And unless you live the two worlds, I'm telling you, you cannot understand what this is all about.
Putting your money where your mouth is.
Exactly.
Honorable Ghati. Let's leave it there.
Exactly.
Let's take a short break here on JKL. Keep those comments coming. Hashtag JKL. Isn't she so inspirational? Giving a voice to those who are often invisible in our society. We'll be talking about the two-thirds gender rule and the gap that you noticed in that piece of legislation. We'll be right back. Stay with us.